went through a period of some frustration in trying to find a design that would adequately reflect the stage, the play, and give us the flexibility that we needed. And after many hours of conversation with Wiz White, I was insisting on a set that suggested some kind of motion of the sea, and I was suggesting a set that helped us to perceive the notion of time in the play, the extremely flexible notion of time in the play. He replied with the concept of a pendulum, the set suspended from the ceiling above, and giving us the kind of motion that suggests both the sea and time.
And the next morning I came in and I ran down to the shop and whipped up a 1-inch scale, very rough model, suspended by rope. And I brought it and I ran up to Tom's office and I said, look at this. What if I could get this motion on the stage? Well, Tom was floored. He couldn't believe it. It was like, this is exactly what we need, but why are you showing this to me? Because it's impossible. Well, I have this problem with the word impossible. As soon as someone says to me, that's impossible, that's my driving force to do it. So I went to the person who is ultimately really responsible for us being able to do this, Mr. Joseph Mulligan, who is a state building engineer and is assigned to several of the state college campuses, Salem State being one. And I went to Joe and I said, look, I know this is an outrageous idea, and I know that probably you should immediately just say no to me, but what do you think the possibilities are of me being able to try a project like this? Now, he said, why don't you put it together in a proposal, and I'll take it into Boston and see what the people at the Office of Architecture and Engineering in Boston say. Why he let me do that, I'll never know. So then we started the process. This was incredible. I'd never had a project like this before in my life. The thing that was so amazing to me was I had to do a scale model using every single piece of material that it would take to build this set. Then I had to figure out what materials in reality I would use, which thank goodness I have people like James Wachowiak and Jim Fallon around to help me find out what the materials are, and we weighed things and went to books of engineering to find out how much they're supposed to weigh, and then we weighed them in reality, and when we went back, I had to weigh each of the actors that were going to be on the ship. We had to find out how much 40 gallons of black paint weighed after the water evaporated out of it. And eventually I came back to Mr. Mulligan with the proposal, and he brought it into Boston, and I have no idea what power he has over those people, but they should have said no. Not because it wasn't safe, but just because they are not into art, and they should have said the building wasn't designed to do this. Why take a chance? No. But they didn't. They said yes. And that's when we started off on this somewhat amazing project. Considering what would happen when we tried to turn the ship in either direction, and could not come up with a satisfactory answer for how that would affect the twisting of the cables. How much tension would we have pushing the opposite direction? And then James Wachowiak came up with a fabulous solution. He said, what about one of those swivel hooks from a crane? So the week before we were going to actually hang the cables up for the ship, I went down to a friend of mine who owns one of the local junkyards, and indeed he did have several 35-ton capacity, a little overkill, but it definitely was worthwhile since our primary concern has to be safety. So we went down to the junkyard and picked up this swivel hook, mounted it the girders from which the ship would eventually be suspended, and then we put our cables to suspend the framework of the ship onto those onto that hook.
This particular set is interesting. One thing about it that is easy is that it doesn't take up much space. It's about 25 feet wide, 25 feet deep, and 16 feet wide. What is hard about it is that it is free floating, suspended from the cables. As far as the concept goes, when I first read the show, Tom Luddy, the director, gave me a copy of the show, I guess it was back in October or November. And I read the show and I thought it was very interesting. I enjoyed the show. In fact, I auditioned for the show and I was cast in it. Wiz's concept first scared me. He came to me one day and said, "I want the ship to be a pendulum. I just want it to swing." And I said, "Fine." The whole idea was that this set was going to be simple. It was going to be three platforms and blacks. Well, there are three platforms and there are blacks, a little more than your 4x8 platforms. But I think it's going to be a success. There are times where things are tense. I'm working on a deadline, trying to get everything done. And I think we're on schedule right now, but we have been working almost constantly, 5 days a week, sometimes six, in addition to teaching. We've definitely worked Saturdays, and I want to see the video, and I think it's going to be a great show. Anything else?
Was first presented to me, I had, having worked with Wiz a number of times, being educated by him and working closely on many other set designs that he's done, it was not something that was unexpected. I thought, again, Wiz had outdone himself and had become in creating something of a first for Salem State, as well as possibly a first in the theater. We're always doing something innovative here, something new, and it lends itself to an exciting kind of atmosphere. I was very excited about this, and the excitement became contagious. The first day that we had the basic structure, just the base steel and aluminum of the set swinging, there were 25 or 30 people just here watching to see what was happening. But it was very exciting. I didn't think it was something that was beyond our reach. I did feel for a while that it was something that would take a great deal of work and possibly stretch us to our limits, but that's the only way we keep growing.
This is the computer light board. The reason we use a computer light board rather than the old rheostat light boards is the fact that on the old rheostat light boards, there was a little dimmer like this for each dimmer. With the computer boards, we have a capacity of up to over 200. With the rheostats, usually the largest capacity was up to 60. And for each cue, you had to set up the next cue. There would be two separate boards. You set up one set of cues on this, bring that cue in, set up the next cue, and have to go into it. Well, the speed of cues was slowed down because you had to have time to set up the level for each dimmer. With this, you can punch in the levels you need for each dimmer, and it's recorded. And all you have to do is hit one fader button, and it comes up, which is what we've got up now. This is one cue, and I can bring up another one in 2 seconds, where normally with an old board, I'd have to set up all the dimmers and bring them up, which is one of the reasons we use a computer light board. If you want to film a sequence, I've got a chase sequence already set up.
My name is Jane Hillier Wolkowiak, and I am a costume designer. I was employed by Salem State College to do this semester's two shows, first one being Final Passages, which is what this video is all about. Richard's costume is basically a type of uniform, although it's not strictly a uniform, if that makes sense. The Countess herself is dressed in mourning for a great part of the play. Other than that, she's in underwear as well. This is the scene where she's going to marry Brand. The actual design of the dress is something that is strictly period, except that the pieces that we've used on this is net curtains. This is net curtains with rhinestones that we've put on. This is net curtains. The only bit of real lace that we've used is the shawl that she wears. The corset we made, and that was from a bit of fabric that was upholstery fabric again. This is an actual cut that I cut from a book that I have that shows you how to cut corsets from the period. The boning in it is polyester, it's not bones, it's not steel or anything like that, which they would have used. This is a lot kinder to the actress than actually encasing her in steel. And the chemise, of course, is something that would have been period. We've tried to stick with period as much as we can, but of course we've had to use theatrical elements to show up on stage, but also for things that we have to do for fast changes, which we have to take into consideration.
I had to train the cast to work on a set that was in constant motion. I had to train them to complement that motion. Sometimes they had to counterbalance the motion of the ship so that it would point in a particular way all the time for the audience. We had to train them to find places to disappear since they could not leave the stage during performance. And finally, I not only had to block the actors, but also to block the ship. And this was a lot of fun to do because it gave us the opportunity to create the illusion of several kinds of movements at one time, without actually having much movement.
One of the things that was definitely an amazing part of the process was the fact that we really didn't know. There's no book to go to that says, when you suspend 5,000 pounds of scenery from 16 3/8 inch cables from approximately 35 feet above, you will get this reaction when someone walks on it. We had no idea what was going to happen when human beings actually walked on this set. I had no idea whether this was really going to work, and yet we were spending, you know, $3,500 and all of our time and energy on this thing. But everyone had faith in me, and my theory was that it would be heavy enough that it would not be directly affected by one or two people's movement, actors' movement on the set. And it ended up that I was right.